الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله الله أكبر الله أكبر ولله الحمد إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونتوب إليه ونتوكل عليه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه من خلقه وخليله أرسله رحمةً للعالمين اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تأسى به واتبع سنته إلى يوم الدين اللهم اجعلنا منهم اللهم آمين إن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن خير الأمور عزائمها وشر الأمور محدثاتها كل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد My dear brothers, sisters, the blessed seerah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us that when he was migrating from Makkah to Medina under the threat of death because the Quraysh was collaborating to kill the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he alayhi salatu wa sallam went with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, his companion, may Allah ta'ala be pleased with him. And on the way, under this dress, under this tough time, you know, a man came after them and reached them. His name was Suraqah bin Malik. And Suraqah bin Malik was a warrior, somebody you would get scared from. And he came out because there was 100 camels as a prize on the head of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, dead or alive. So he caught up with them. And when he wanted to charge at him, at the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr, the horse's feet sunk into the sand. So Suraqah said to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr, call upon your Lord, ud'uwa rabbakuma, that he would lift my horse's feet from the sand. So Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did so, and Suraqah was able to get his horse out of the sand. And then he charged at them again. And when he charged again, the horse sunk even deeper. So he repeated the same request. Please ask Allah Ta'ala to bring him. Because remember, the mushrikeen used to believe in Allah. They only associated partners with him. So he told them, please call upon Allah, your Lord, so that he would save my horse and save me. And sure enough, the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam made the dua and the man was free again. And then the Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him, what do you think, Suraqah? And Suraqah was not a Muslim yet. He said, what do you think, Suraqah, that you will wear the bracelets of Kisra, the king, the emperor of the Persian, the Persian Empire? He said, you're talking about Kisra bin Hormuz, the one whose palaces, the white palaces in Iraq, that was known? He said, that Kisra. What does that tell us? Because the days passed, the years passed, and not only that, Suraqah came to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at the conquest of Mecca and declared his shahada and became a Muslim. And then at the time of Umar bin Khattab, towards the end of it, when the Muslims conquered Iraq, and all the jewelry and the clothes of Kisra, the king of that empire, came to Umar bin Khattab, and Suraqah was there. And Suraqah said, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam promised me to wear them. And he wore the bracelets of Kisra. What does that tell us? It tells us that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew that he is going to go to Medina, establish the Islamic State, that Islamic State is going to have an army, and that army is going to fight the Persians. Not only fight them, but they are going to beat them. And when they beat them, all of that booty, all that booty of war is going to come to the Muslims, and Suraqah is going to be wearing them. After Suraqah becoming a Muslim, he knew that he is going to become a Muslim even before he declared the Shahada. The same man who was being chased out of Mecca with a price on his head. Few years later, comes back and conquers Mecca. That's the confidence. That's the trust in the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's the trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not abandon his ibad. That he will not abandon this ummah. That Allah ta'ala will make this deen victorious. The seerah of our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells us in the same journey of al-Hijrah that the Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam hid with his companion Abu Bakr as-Siddiq in Ghar al-Thawb, in a crate, in a cave. And the mushrikeen came looking for them. And they stood on top of the cave. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq got scared. And he said, Ya Rasulullah, لو نظر أحدهم موضع قدميه لرآنا. If one of them just looks at them below his feet, they will see us because we're underneath them. And Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with the tranquility of the mu'min, the tranquility of the one who has the full confidence and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, Ya Abu Bakr, مَا ظَنُّكَ بِثْنَيْنِي اللَّهُ ثَالِثُهُمَا. What do you think about two people and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is their third? That is the confidence and the trust of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the victory of Allah. Shouldn't we believers have the same confidence and trust in the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect this ummah, that will make this deen victorious? This is his ummah. This is his deen. This is his book. This is his sharia. There is no doubt that Allah ta'ala will do so. Some of us weaken. And some of us get pressured by the reality that we are living. We look at the Muslims being tortured and persecuted all over the world. We see the Muslims in China. Over a million, and some estimates close to 2 million Muslims being, incarcerated and being forced to abandon their deen. We look at the Muslims in Afghanistan and how the annihilation of our Muslims in Afghanistan took without count of how many Muslim lives they killed. When we look at the Muslims all over the world, in India, now the Muslims in India, they are even having problems even just dressing as Muslims. They are coming to the masajid and they are torching masajid while the Muslims are in them. Campaigns go from house to house to the Muslim neighborhoods and to torture them alive while they are in their houses. They lock the doors on them. So the person looks at that. And the person looks at the so-called Muslim world. And you see that even the so-called Muslim rulers, now they are not only attacking Islam, allowing what they call the Abrahamic faith, allowing what is called, the normalization with the enemies of Islam and the people who have occupied Muslim lands. On top of it, they're preventing Muslims from doing Salat al-Tahajjud in the Masjid. They're preventing them from doing Qiyam. They told them that there is no Qiyam. Go do Qiyam at home. The Tahajjud is not allowed in the countries of Muslims. When the Muslim sees that, or lastly what we see from the Zionist entity going into the Masjid al-Aqsa al-Mubarak and going and beating and killing and destroying and, all of this, we see it as some people weaken. They forget that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made this world a world of test for everybody. هو الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. This is the world that Allah ta'ala created so that the test be done. And so that we are tested because of our iman. أحسب الذين آمنوا يقولوا آمنا وهم لا يفتنون. Do the people who believe, they declare their iman, do they believe, do they think that they will be, allowed to exist just without being tested because of their iman? It is a test. We have to be assured of the victory of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anybody who has doubt, you look at what happened to Quraysh in history. What happened to Quraysh? What happened to the Mughals? What happened to the Tatars? What happened to the Crusades? All of them are gone. All of them were defeated. And Islam remained. And the Muslim Ummah remained. And not only in its weakest time, which is today, to my knowledge, the weakest time of the Muslim Ummah, still Islam is the most widest spreading. And estimates about 2000, in 2060, you have the majority of the world religions will be Muslims. Despite our defeat, Islam never got defeated. Muslims, yes, we have been defeated. But Islam cannot be defeated. So we have to take that belief, that conviction, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this deen victorious. Never think somebody is too powerful for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This, the idea of confrontation and the idea of victory of Allah ta'ala, is a long-term issue. It is not something that happens overnight or something that changes overnight. And at the end of the day, alaysa Allahu bikafin 'abda. وَيُخَوِّفُونَكَ بِالَّذِينَ هُمْ مِنْ دُونِهِ. That isn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enough for his abd, for his servant, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they try to frighten you with somebody who is below them. Rest assured that the future is for Islam, and the future is for the Muslim Ummah, and the future is for the domination of Islam. And this is a trust and this is a promise from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَدَ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنْكُمْ وَعَمُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ لَأَسْتَخْلِفَنَّهُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَلَيُمَكِّنَنَّ لَهُمْ دِينَهُمْ الَّذِي ارْتَضَى لَهُمْ يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا وَلَيُمَكِّنَ لَهُمْ مِنْ دُونِهِ مَا قَضَوْا وَلَيُبَدِّلَ لَهُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ خَوْفِهِمْ أَمْنًا يَعْبُدُونَنِي لَا يُشْرِكُونَ بِي شَيْئًا. This is a promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ أَصْدَقُ مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلًا. أَقُولُ قَوْلِي هَذَا وَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ يَا فَوْزَ الْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. You know, my brothers, my sisters, before we leave, and this is a sort of a different topic. You know, some of us come to the masjid only in Ramadan. Some of us come only to the masjid for Eid. Isn't it about time that we attached our hearts and our lives to the masjid? Isn't it about time that we understand the saying of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that إِنَّمَا يَأْكُلُ الذِّئْبُ مِنْ غَنَمِ الْقَاصِيَةِ, that the wolf only eats a lone sheep. You know, nobody, we strengthen ourselves with each other. We firmen ourselves with each other by being in the Muslim community. Let's not be da'i Muslims, and let's not be the Ramadan Muslims. Let's be the Muslims all the time. And let's keep this masjid alive with our breath, with our takbir, with our tahleel, with our tahmeed, you know, with our worship. This is how we keep the masjid alive. And if we want to have our children grow up as Muslims, don't expect them to grow up away from the Muslim community and remain Muslims. There has to be an influence. And if there is no influence on them, there are no peers, there are no Muslim friends, there is no good role models that they look at, there is no understanding of Islam and learning from Islam, how do we expect them to exist? How do we expect them to function as Muslims in the future generations? This is your masjid. This is not anybody's masjid. Your money built it. You built it so that you can pray in it. You built it so that you can learn the deen in it. You built it so that your children can do the same. This is your masjid. You need to be here for those who only come occasionally. You know, we need to look at our lives. At the end of the day, by Allah, what is the conclusion of all of this life? Either heaven or hell. There is no third conclusion. There is no third destination. Let's attach ourselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Attach ourselves to the believers who are better than us. You know, we learn from them and we remind each other and we learn from each other, and so that we serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala better, so that our akhirah, as well as our dunya, is better, inshaAllah ta'ala. The other thing that really needs to be said is that, you know, all of us came to pray the month of Ramadan, and we prayed and we found the carpet spread out, and we found the mic is ready, and you find the people, Allah is Yafir, Muhammad Haida, my brother, you know, leading the Taraweeh, Hassan Ali, leading Taraweeh, leading the Salah consistently, night after night. You have people that we don't know who made all of this happen. Before any iftar, you have people who come and they prepare, they leave their families, or they come with their families. You find their wives helping, they find their children helping, they find them helping. May Allah Ta'ala reward them. Mm-hmm. And may Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala accept from them. Because لَمَّنْ لَمْ يَشْكُرِ النَّاسَ لَمْ يَشْكُرِ اللَّهِ. Whoever is not thankful to the people is not thankful to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. And finally, we have, you know, a brother, you know, whose wife is sick. You know, may Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala cure her. She was admitted in the hospital yesterday. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give her the shifa. And remember, you know, this is a custom of the masjid. We have every Eid, we have donuts that are actually they're donated by the brothers who do the donuts. And this family was, the brother was out of town, he came back specially to make the donuts so that we can maybe raise our sugar level. But it is done, you know, with love, and it's done for the Muslim community. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him for his effort, and may Allah ta'ala accept it from him. May Allah ta'ala accept our ibadah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us for all our shortcomings in Ramadan. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins outside of Ramadan. And may He subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our actions. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept our ibadah. And make us from the righteous amongst the believers. Allahumma ighfir lana dhunubana wa israfana fi amrina. Allahumma ij'alna min 'ibadika as-salihin. ربنا تقبل منا انك انت السميع العليم وتب علينا يا مولانا انك انت التواب الرحيم وصل اللهم وسلم على محمد النبي الامي وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين عيد مبارك ان شاء الله and do not forget to visit your families this is the arham keep good connections call your families call your parents call whoever you need to call you know especially